Yeah, hello everyone. First of all, a very happy new year to all of you. With the new year, we at Computer Vision Talks have started a new initiative that is a tutorial series on general research topics. And today we have with us Chinmay Mishra, who will be discussing about social robotics. A bit insight about Chinmay. He has completed his BTech in Computer Science and Engineering from ITER Bhubaneswar in 2012. Then he went on to pursue his master's in intelligent systems from TU Kaiserslautern, Germany. And now he's a PhD fellow at Furhed Robotics, Stockholm. Today, he is here to talk about social robotics. We look forward to your talk, Chinmay. Thank you.
Thank you so much for the nice introduction. So, hi everyone, and happy New Year to you as well. So, just to clarify it, it's pronounced Kaiserslautern.
Yeah, I'm sorry for that.
No, just right. For the people to know, right? It's difficult.
Yeah, right.
Anyways, so I'll share my screen.
One second.
Sound. Okay, can you see the presentation?
Yes.
Okay, and you're also able to see the cursor and everything?
Yes.
Awesome. Okay, start. Okay, so what we'll be trying to do right now is I'll try to introduce this field of social robotics, and I'll try to also broadly cover what are the aspects of the social robotics in general. So in this duration of this talk, we'll try to formulate a working definition of what is social robotics, right? Then we'll see what are the types of robots or what are the types of social robots that are already available to us, and see the types and see if we can classify them into certain categories. And then we'll tackle this question of why even do this? Like, what is the motivation behind doing social robotics at all? And then I'll be focusing mainly on why it is an intersection of multiple disciplines, why it is interdisciplinary. So this, I'll mainly be focusing on how it is a good platform for interdisciplinary research, right? And then at the end, we could always have this discussion about, are we actually going to create Skynet or iRobot? So we could discuss that. So we'll do it this way that whenever you have some questions, feel free to interrupt me and ask questions. So let's have it more of a discussion than me talking and you guys trying hard not to fall asleep, right? Okay, so let's start with this small clip. So this is a clip from a movie called Big Hero 6. So let's just hope that you guys hear it as well.
To help. You can't fix this one, buddy. What are you doing?
I am downloading a database on personal log. Downloaded. Treatments include contact with friends and loved ones. I am contacting them now.
No, I don't do
Your
that.
Your friends have been contacted.
Unbelievable. Now what are you doing?
Other treatments include compassion and physical reassurance.
Hey, really?
You will be all right. There.
So, this is a small clip, right? That's a robot and it's trying to console this kid. So, this is what we expect out of social robots in general. Like, this entire clip is what we are trying to research and achieve. So, of course, I mean, you could see that it was not very human. Like, I mean, no human will go and touch the computer and say, I'm downloading the database, or like, you will not say these certain things aloud. But what you can observe here is that there is natural communication happening between both of them. There is an emotional connect. They are able to. So what the main thing that you should take away from this clip is there is a social interaction happening. So they are trying to socially interact. meaning there is emotions involved, there is a natural seamless conversation happening, natural language communication, right? And so with that, let's try to see if we can define the field. So like over the years, there have been attempts to properly define social robotics, and I have listed three of them. So social robots, as you can see here, so what they said that, okay, social robot is something that should have a social interface, should be socially evocative, socially receptive, should be sociable. So I like n number of things which are something that we expect from society. Or Hegel et al. So they said that they basically reduced all of these bubbles into one. They said, okay, a robot with a social interface is something that we say a social robot. Then we also have this definition where they say a social robot would be an autonomous or semi-autonomous robot that interacts and communicates with humans. And this is important, by following the behavioral norms expected by people with whom they interact. So the main key point in all of these types of definition you would find is that what we are trying to achieve is we are trying to create something that is that can pass as a social entity, not just as a like a robot or a tool or something, but a social entity. Now, what do I mean when I say a social entity? A social entity, so you, me, all of us are social entities, meaning in a society, we have our identity. In a society, there are certain things that are expected out of us. There are some rules of engagement in a society, which we are expected to follow. So we are also targeting that social robots should also be a social entity, meaning they should be socially situated. They should also like follow or adhere to the norms of a society and be perceived by humans as something, not just a toy, but something like that has an identity in a society, right? Now, when I say this, some of you might also think like, okay, are we like trying to create another human being or another species? That's partially true, but we could also like think of something as a pet. A pet is not a human being, right? But it's still a social entity. There are certain social norms that you expect a pet to follow. So in similar way, we are trying to somehow create a companion or create a social entity which can communicate and interact with humans in a social setting, right? So that would how I would define social robotics. Coming to the types of robots, like these are a few popular robots that are already out there in the market. So this is the robot that I am working on, Farhat. This is Asimo. I mean, it's probably one of the most famous robots throughout the time. If I'm not wrong, it's probably decommissioned. They're not continuing the manufacturing of this robot. Two latest way too popular robots are the Now robot and Pepper. I mean, I see a lot of papers and a lot of researchers like working on these two robots. This is, I think, JIBO or AIBO, I forgot the name. And this is Cosmo. And this one is probably Cruiser or something. So these are a few robots that are already available. Now, if we had to categorize these robots, into some in some way. So like what would that be? So the first is humanoid and non-humanoid. Now, when I say humanoid, so we need to define what is a humanoid robot. So humanoid robot, so the very definition of humanoid, that means it somehow resembles a human being, right? So you see this Now robot, it somehow resembles a human being, but it's not exactly a lookalike of a human. Right, so it has like two legs, two hands, a torso, a head. So this is a humanoid robot. Even this is a humanoid robot. I mean, obviously this, the lower body is not, it doesn't have two legs. It has just wheels instead of legs. But still, when you see this, you can somehow relate that, okay, it somehow resembles a human being, right? It has a head, kind of a head, two arms and a body. So what is a non-humanoid robot then? Then you have this Cosmo. It's definitely a non-humanoid robot. It has nothing to do with human beings, except probably these two eyes type of things, right? Many people confuse humanoid and android. Like, so there is a difference between what is a humanoid and what is an android. Now, you might have seen a few robots that are so similar to human beings that it's totally impossible to understand whether it's a human or whether it's a robot. So those are androids. Their main motivation is to create robots that look exactly like human beings. So that's an android. But humanoid is where you have a bit of flexibility. You take inspiration from the humanoid form, the human form, but you are free to like incorporate it in any way you can. So even for Hattier, you could also argue that it's kind of humanoid. I mean, it doesn't have a lower body, but it has just the upper body from the neck and above. Then based on the locomotion, then you have a stationary or a mobile robot. For example, Cosmo here would be a mobile robot, but Farhat here is a stationary robot. It cannot move, right? So these are few broad categories that I can think of. Also, I think it would be good to mention here, if you think about, so we've just discussed about social entities, right? I'm not sure if you guys have heard about the news of this robot called Sophia, which was awarded the citizenship by UAE. Right?
Yeah, so and that, it visited IIT BHU.
Yeah. I didn't know that. Okay.
Yeah, it did.
So that's a social entity. I mean, that's just nonsense PR stunt, but still. So that's what we expect, that's a social entity now, right? It is a citizen and it is a part of society now. So that's a social robot for you. Okay. So now, why at all? Like, why are we even researching this? So I think the best way to answer this question, I mean, we would have a number of motivation, but I think it's always easier to explain it when we talk about the applications. So where can we apply social robots? So let's take, for example, elderly care. So we have these old age homes, and consider the situation where there is COVID now. Now, then people, the caretakers, they are unable to reach and they are unable to provide care because of COVID. Now, imagine a robot there. It's if we are able to create a robot which is able to evoke emotions, which is able to take care as any human being could, then that would be such a help for elderly age, like elder people in old age homes, right? Let's take, for example, the medical scenario. So much time is lost by the nurses, instead of going and attending a patient, they lose so much time just asking the repetitive questions, what is your name, or filling up these forms, or like recording your BP. I mean, these are certain things that could be automated. So we could always have a robot which can pre-screen the patient, fill up these forms, and give it to the nurses. And then by the time you reach the nurse or the doctor, you are talking substance. You are not going through this mundane stuff, like, okay, which is required, of course, but then you are not losing time there. I just talked about emotional support. So robots could, for example, imagine Farhat, like I'm sitting here and I'm feeling down. Let's say the robot is able to perceive that, oh, this person is probably not in the best of mood. Let me try to entertain. It could just suggest me something. It could sing a song. It could do so many things. So that could be one. Of course, personal assistant. I mean, we all these days we are using personal assistant. Like I use Siri. Some of you might be using Amazon Polly or maybe Google Home. So that's already there. But what we lack, like we just take the phone, hey Siri, and then that's it, right? But if you have a situated robot, if you have some physical embodiment, then it becomes you. There is this more connect to it. Right, you are able to connect, you are able to converse. Also, if it has a physical body, then it is able to do so much more. Like when, let's say Siri is directing you in a map, take a right here. It won't say take a right here. Siri would say like take a right at 400 meters. But let's say you had a robot, it'll look, take a right here. Right, this gestures and all this stuff is not possible. So of course we could do those things. We could teach people in remote corners of the world where there are no teachers available. There is a thing called telepresence. So let me go back to the slide. It's easier to imagine now. So let's consider this robot or even Farhat even. So now see, you're able to, so this is a backlit projected mask, right? So you are projecting the face onto a plastic surface here. So now imagine, let's take the COVID scenario. So I am unable to go and attend a meeting physically. But what I could do is I just switch on the webcam and I project my face onto Farhat. And now I have a telepresence. So I am substituting myself as a robot. And then it is able to telepathy. You can also look at people and the robot can move around. And then it makes the communication more interactive, right? These are a few.
The similar example brings in a case that say some student has a chronic disease due to which he has to always be in a hospital, and yet he wants to interact socially with the classmates. So rather than just being on a video conference, wouldn't it be better to have a robot that can be mobile, move around, and
perfectly, yes, definitely, yes. So,
and also, I would say. In our case, attending conferences right now is all virtual. So this could maybe make it better. So
No. I am not definitely not going to substitute robots for conferences. I would like to travel. Also, like think about safety and security. I mean, I'm not talking about robot soldiers here. Let me make it very clear. What I'm talking about is, let's stick to the example of elderly care. So the robot has nowadays using machine learning or deep learning or all these nice tools, we are able to predict certain things. We're able to see whether, let's say the robot is able to predict, oh, this person is about to fall. Now, let's assume that the robot doesn't have hands to catch. It's just a sitting duck, like it's a stationary robot like Farhat. But it can at least identify, oh, the person is about to fall or the person has fallen down. And then depending on the situation, it could always contact the emergency services. It could raise an alarm. So when there is no one around, but there is this robot, at least it will be able to save your life because there was timely help due to this robot raising alarm, right? So that's what I mean by safety and security. So these are a few applications, and I hope that this kind of answers the question why, because we have so many reasons why we should be working on it, right? Now I stressed on how social robotics is a field where we are, like, it's an intersection or it's a platform for interdisciplinary research. So I've tried to mention a few fields that I could think of. There must be more than this, of course, and I mean there is not enough space to list all of these. But let's see, let's start with this psychology thing. I mean, it's probably intuitive at this point that why we need psychology. So what is psychology? We are trying to research how our cognition works or what are the things that takes place, what are the mechanism or what is the control architecture behind taking certain decisions or doing the things that the way we do. So if we are trying to build a robot that is able to communicate with human beings in a social setting like a human being, then it's definitely necessary that we base our research in psychology so that it resembles human beings, and then humans have this connect. Humans are able to connect with the robot, and then there is a natural conversation. So all this conversation that we have with Siri or all these voice assistants, this is not natural. I mean, every time when you have to say, hey Siri, or hello Google, or okay Google, it's not natural. That's not how human beings talk, right? Like, I'll not say, hey Sambhavi, and then I start a sentence. Never. So, right. Of course. So, yeah, you're saying something?
No, just I was agreeing. Yeah.
Okay. Then comes philosophy. I mean, many people sadly do not consider philosophy to be to be scientific enough, which is sad. But why is philosophy necessary? Because philosophy also teaches you about ethics. And without ethics, what are we even building? Like, probably you guys came across a lot of discussion that has been taking place recently about all these, how models are biased, deep learning models are biased and all this stuff. So if a deep learning model can be biased, imagine what will happen in a social robot that we are thinking of integrating into the society. If we do not follow proper ethics, and if we do not have proper standards to stick to, it would basically be inviting disaster, right? So we need philosophy. Medicine, I just talked about, it could pre-screen patients in a hospital. astrophysics. So there is this project by NASA that's going on, the Artemis project. I don't know if you have heard about it. So they're trying to land on moon by 2024. So in Artemis project, they're actually planning to deploy a humanoid robot there, which will be helping the astronauts. So there is a lot of research going on in this domain. Then we have biology. It could vary, like it could, so one thing that comes off in my mind is like, all these robots that we built are somewhere or other biologically motivated. So we study how human beings, let's say like how they move or how they walk. And based on that, we try to model these things into robots. So of course, biology plays a crucial role. I mean, I think it's prudent to mention that computer science is involved, right? And then we have art and design. So how does the robot, how should it look like? So this is not just how should it look like, but it's more about how should it be perceived as well. How do I make it look less intimidating and more friendly, right? So many things. Electronics, engineering, of course, I mean, I could just go on about those things. I mean, imagine you have to take into account what are the motors, how should the muscles be? Should it be a pneumatic muscle? Should it be a motor? Like, what are the things that, like, you imagine, let's just stick to muscles maybe. So we have these, let's take two types of motors. We have the normal servo motors, and then we have some pneumatic muscles, which are like, operated using this hydro, like air pressure and all this stuff. So what comes into mind when you try to design these things? So one would be like the capabilities, how easier is it to manipulate using these motors? But at the same time, you also have to think about the noise it creates. So I was using a robot that had pneumatic muscles. So every time there was the smallest of gestures would create the loudest of noise. And then in these scenarios, you just cannot have a good conversation if all you listen to is noise, hissing noises or sounds. But at the same time, you do not have a lot of control in other things like motors. Then you have to consider the energy that is required. And then comes this mechanics, the mechatronics part of the robotics. Imagine the locomotion, how should it walk? How should the wheels be? I think you are working on SLAM, right, Swaru? Or was it Chinmay? Who was working on SLAM? I forgot.
I am working on SLAM.
Yeah, so you need, definitely you need SLAM for a social robot. I mean, we cannot have this robot going and hitting the wall or hitting a person.
Right.
And also like the hardware, what type of skin? So I just talked about Farhat having a plastic mask where we are projecting the face, but a lot of robots, a lot of social robots, they actually have skins, silicon-based skins. And then they have this, so we have something called action units on a face, which are responsible for expressions or facial expressions. So action units are basically the, think of it as the attention points on your face, which need to move, or which are the muscle points which move in order to complete a particular expression like smile or sadness or something. So imagine them trying to like connect these attention points with threads and say like on the silicon mask, and then those threads are connected to the motors, and then they try to emulate the emotion. So a lot of engineering work goes on to creating this single robot. Now let's try to focus a bit more into it. Let's say, let's take computer science, and in particular, let's take AI. So what are the things that are required to build a social robot? Of course, computer vision. I mean, you need to be able to see, you need to be able to perceive people. Okay, there is a person. Who is this person? Is he speaking? Is he moving? Is he doing some gesture, or is it random gesture? So you need pattern recognition. Right, you need gesture recognition. You need to see what action it is taking. So action recognition, right? You need to be able to, so if it is a mobile robot, you need to perceive the objects, you need to perceive the obstructions, the normal things with SLAM and all this stuff. Knowledge management, how now you cannot always have a robot which is repeating itself. So you need to somehow build a theory of mind. So how do you do that? So you somehow have to have an architecture that is able to like collect knowledge, somehow arrange it, and also be able to access that knowledge and use it when talking. So let's say I talk to Swaroop, and then I'm the robot and I talk to Swaroop. So hi Swaroop, can you say hello? And then over the conversation, I got that, okay, Swaroop is a man. Swaroop stays in India. Swaroop is an undergrad student. So these are certain things that I take and then I store somewhere. And the next time I come, I see, while talking to Swaroop, I suddenly see, oh, I don't know who Swaroop's friends are. So as a robot, what I could do is I'll ask, oh, Swaroop, do you have any friends? And then I let's say Swaroop say, oh, Shambhavi is Swaroop's friend. And then we know, okay. Then I somehow have to have this information that, okay, Swaroop's friend is Shambhavi. And then you build a model for Shambhavi. Shambhavi is a girl, stays in India. And so you see how the knowledge management takes place, right? Okay. So what else? Like you have this speech. Now I talked a bit about this perception and about management. But also we have generation, which is something unique to this field, I would say. So like you're working on computer vision. Most of you have been working on computer vision. So mainly you are into the perception side. You see something and then you process, you make models to detect or identify or to alert about something. But now in this field, you can actually use that and generate something in return. So what can you generate? You can generate gestures, all the hand gesture, the facial expressions, the nodding of head, the movements, the body posture, so many things. So you can generate them. You can generate speech. And imagine, so just take into consideration the entire conversation process. So I say something, the robot listens to it, then robot does an ASR. So then it has a speech to text, then it has text on text, then it has to do the NLP process, which is natural language understanding, then it generates a natural language, then you have text to speech, and then you have a speech synthesis. So the entire architecture is a single part of social robotics, right? So this is how this is why I keep on saying that this is social robotics is a place where you can have so many things intersecting each other, and all of these things need to come together for making a perfect or at least a passable social robot, right? Now let's focus even more. So I talked about all this stuff. So there is also a thing called emotion modeling, right? How do we model emotion? How can we have emotional conversation or emotion invoked during a conversation with the robots? So let's take an example, because it's easier always to work with an example, right? So let's say that Farhat is interacting with all these children, and let's assume that they are playing a game, maybe a card game, let's say. Yeah. So if I am modeling emotion, what can my robot do when playing the game? So let's say when playing the game, and so the boy in red here, he played a card, and once this boy plays that card, Farhat loses, let's say. So now the Farhat, if it were able to express emotions as a human would, then what should we expect a human to do in that case? Like it will become sad or maybe become angry. So we expect Farhat to be angry, or we expect Farhat to be sad when it loses. Or let's say it was a group game. Then let's say the red boy and Farhat were in the same team and they win now. So now the expected output would be that both of them become happy. Farhat becomes happy, or in certain cases, Farhat could console a friend if they lose, celebrate with the team. So all these things can be done just if you are trying to model emotion, right? And if I were to dig a bit deeper and show you how this emotion modeling is done. So let's say, so what are the inputs in this case? So we have people talking around. So we have the acoustic, we have the audio data, right? We have the gestures or the actions that are taking place. So you are placing the card, that's an action. So you are placing a card, you are playing the card, that's an action. So maybe you said something, you played the card. So we have the audio, we have the action, We have some speech that is going on. We have the expressions that the robot can see on the faces of other participants. We have the object detection, like what is the card, which card is being played, and all of this is what we call a multimodal input. So they will be fed into an emotion space model. Now, to talk about emotion space models very simply, so these are something the researcher in psychology have been working on. So their main motto or main aim is to somehow come up with these dimensional spaces where they can model or where they can model emotion. This, like, let's take for example the AV model. So it only has two dimensions, one being arousal, the other being valence, right? What is arousal and valence? Arousal is how intense your actions are or the stimuli that you are seeing. So let's say you are placing a card. So there is a lot of motion involved when you are placing a card. So you raise your hand and you place the card on the table. There is a lot of action. So your arousal value would be high, right? So somewhere in the positive axis. Now let's say the card that you play would ultimately make me lose, the robot. So that's a displeasing thing. So valence means how pleasant or displeasing is the action that is taking place now. So you would have somewhere a negative valence. So you would end up reaching somewhere in this quadrant. And if you zoom in, so this is the circumflex model. You can check it. I have also given the references. So if you zoom in, you will see all these negative emotions here. You would have anger, you would have, depression or some of these emotions. So this is an emotion space model that we take from psychology. So we take all these inputs, we find a way to numerically represent them as this dimension of a emotion space model, like arousal and valence, and then we feed it to a behavior control architecture. Now, I was talking about all this gesture generation, expression generation, speech generation, but we need to have a control over it. How do you, in what case, what is expected? So that will be taken care of by this control architecture. Now you could have a machine learning model to do that. You could have a heuristic model, rule-based model. You could have a hybrid model. It depends on which is the best fit for you. So once you have this behavior control architecture, and then you again have a multidimensional output. How you could vary the tone of what is being said. Select what to say, how to say. You could select the expression that needs to be performed, like sad or angry if it loses the game. You could say, think of it like, let's say it just looks away, the gesture. So it became angry. So it maybe said, oh no. So that's the intonation, that's the speech. And then it made a face, angry face, and then it looked away. So you have at least four different types of output. So this is how it works. Now, all I explained was only emotion modeling. So take into consideration this example again, where we are playing cards with Farhad. Now imagine all the other things that you could do as well. Like you could track these things. You could also have a control architecture or the behavior architecture where maybe if somebody moves too close to the robot, then robot should be, oh, you're coming too close. So reactions, you could model reactions. You have this entire NLP task going on. You have this entire object detection task going on. So many things are happening in one place, right? And of course, like we could discuss the doomsday, but I think I will show you this video of a robot. Let me see. So I have with me the Farhad robot. Let me.
I guess the video is not pinned, so it is not showing up. No, yeah, it is.
Now I've spotlighted the video. I think everyone can see the video now.
Yes.
Can you see it?
Yeah.
Now let me. Oh, God. Okay, my old laptop is betraying.
So it blinks eyes as well.
Yeah. I mean, that's so we have modeled the system to somehow. So the entire purpose of making this social robot is to emulate human beings, right? So we try to keep all the things that are possible. Like blinking is something that we naturally do. You can also see that the eyes will not stay focused on the same place. Like you can see it will be moving around a bit, slight flicker.
Does it dilate the pupil when light is
not really. That would be like then we are going too much into specialization. But of course it is possible. Okay, let me run
a scenario. And what are the responses is it capable of?
Wait, just a second. Hey Farhat, start the presentation.
Oh, hello there. My name is Farhat, and I'm a certified intelligent robot. For fear. I can have different personalities. I can look like a woman. Who's still like a woman, or like a man, like a famous robot. Do you recognize me? I also have built-in LEDs. I can show a variety of colors, for example, these ones. These are exciting times. To believe that great things are about to happen between social robots and humans. I'm really happy to be here, and I'm really looking forward to getting to know all these smart people.
Thank you, Farhat. So.
Great. Very impressive.
All right, we can unpin this video.
Oh yeah, it's done.
Yeah, so that's basically everything from me. Now we can just have some discussions. We could discuss any doubts you might have or any interesting things.
When we're looking at the robot, mm-hmm. What are the major components that went into the construction? How would you divide the whole social robotics thing? One would be perception.
Mm-hmm. I still do not get the clarity, like the question, like what are the different aspects?
Yeah, the components of a robot. How do you judge it? Like how many different type of teams are involved into constructing one robot and what are technologies that are basically going into it?
I mean, let's just stick to computer science. I mean, like I mentioned in my other slides, you have so many fields working together. Like we could discuss the material that needs to be used for building a robot to, we could discuss about the motors or the electronic components that needs to be built. But let's just stick to the computer science maybe. So right off the bat, you can segregate it into at least three parts. One would be the perception part. One would be the processing part, and then the other would be the generation part. So that's the three main components or three main segregation that you need to build any robot. So perception, then you have all this stuff, like you have the NLP, you have this computer, like vision, and number of things. You can have anything. Like you have sensors, like you have these proximity sensors, you have the, let's say, IMUs to balance the robot, maybe to see how fast the robot is going. You have the light detection sensors. I mean, so many sensors are also integrated into a robot just to make it work, right? And then you have the processing part, which is basically the control. So you, how do you process all the signals that you're receiving from the sensors, the cameras, and all this perception system, basically. I mean, you could also have haptic sensors, like, how to touch, what is the pressure, and all sorts of input data. So how do you process it? How do you make it available to your models? And then you have the models for architectures or the behavior control that I was discussing about. So how do we generate which particular gesture is appropriate at this situation, or which type of expression needs to be done? Should the robot, let's say the sensor says the robot is about to fall, what is the action that the robot needs to take to correct itself? So all these things. So yeah, three parts at least.
Right. And like if someone is starting on his or her own into social robotics and does not mm-hmm. has the resources to access a lab, mm-hmm. so what would you suggest? Like to start with perception, build on things?
I mean, why not? One of the biggest demerits of social robotics is quite limited or restricted by the platform that is being used. So all these platforms have their own operating system or maybe their own coding language, their own architecture. So it's restricted in that sense. But of course, I mean, perception is something that's not restricted. You could always think of a problem statement like maybe detecting all the objects in the environment and having a mental model or mental map of it. Or you could always imagine building a conversation system. So maybe you need to adapt your conversation system to a specific robot. But if it is generic enough to be implemented in any of these robots, then you don't actually need a robot. You could always maybe have this system in place and then adapt it to the robot that is available to you. Also, you have access to simulations. So you could always try and run these things on simulated environments and then see if you get an opportunity.
Simulation as in?
So you have robotic simulations, like for example, you can visit Farhat, you can go there and then it has a simulated robot. The SDK gives you a simulated robot where you can start interacting right off the bat. You can start implementing models, you can start interaction models and all this stuff. So maybe it's not as optimal as something that like having a robot because you wouldn't have access to the camera, but you could always rig your laptop's camera and make it seem that you are interacting with the robot. So there are workarounds if you want. It's not necessary that you need to have access to a social robot to start, but yeah, it's not very straightforward to search for these things. Yeah, the necessary is connecting to people and asking around.
Also, I was wondering, like, if we have multimodal input for the robots, then mm-hmm. where is the computation being going on and being held? So, is it like there's a system embedded in it, or is it going on a cloud somewhere, in a central server or something?
It's both ways. So, of course, you would want to process as many things locally as possible because it is faster that way. Yeah. But then again, you have to also think of the other things like just running a robot. Forget about this processing of multimodal inputs. Just having an architecture that makes the robot run, control variable, like initiate all these systems and everything. So if you have you do not have a lot of space inside a robot to put so many components, right? So yeah, the smaller those processors are, the better for robots. But then we always have this option. Nowadays, we hardly use local systems. We are all targeting cloud systems. So, of course, the robot has to adapt to that. So, you have a hybrid model kind of thing, mostly, where you do certain processes locally, but the major process, let's say, like learning some models, that will happen on the cloud, but the learned model will be put on the robot, and then you use it. Something like
that. Right. And I think the robot needs to, adapt to its environment quickly. So is there continual learning going on too?
Then again, it depends on the robot and it depends on the application. So of course, if you are targeting to have a robot which needs to adapt, like you might have seen these videos from Boston Dynamics.
Yeah, dancing.
They're kicking or the robot is dancing and there are obstacles. So in that application, definitely the robot needs to be aware of the surrounding and adapt quickly. So mm-hmm. those are certain processes that would definitely be taking place locally. But then again, these are also some models, right? I don't think we have reached a place where it's just we have a model for everything and then it just adapts automatically. You have to know that this is something that can happen and then you just plan certain steps that can mitigate it. That's it. So if you have not thought of this possibility, then it's highly likely that the model will fail.
Right. So it can be concluded that a social robot, will always pass a Turing test.
Not necessarily. It depends on how you define Turing test. I think these days it's we are having these discussions that Turing test might not be enough to differentiate between a human and a robot. Like if you use any BERT model and you are having a conversation with the chatbot, then I'm pretty sure just defining like just by the parameters of Turing test, we won't be able to know if it is a human or a robot.
Right. So from your perspective, from your opinion, what are the different factors, like apart from Turing test, that are necessary?
So what is the motivation? Like, why do we even have a Turing test? Because that was probably just for fun or something. Like, why at all?
So you can't differentiate between a human and a machine, basically. So
right, but so when we are talking about robots, so it was easy with this chat bots because it just text. Then you don't know what you are interacting. But when it comes to a robot, you already see a robot. So unless it is an Android robot that I talked about, then you always know you are talking to a robot. So it already failed during testing that.
Right.
But I believe that what we are trying to achieve is not that we are creating another person, but have something that is able to interact with. So the conversation with the robot is never going to be the same as conversing with a human being. Maybe in some future ahead, probably, I don't know. But right now, at least from what I can say, it's definitely going to be an interaction with a robot. There will always this thing in your back of the mind that, okay, it's a robot, it's anyways dumb, or maybe it's not understanding. Or maybe it's just my bias because I have worked with robots and I assume that people would think of it that way, which is a bad thing. You should not have bias in research. But still, so what we are trying to achieve is have a natural conversation. So when I say, so one thing you might have noticed, if you have worked on NLP, you might have noticed that it is very difficult to retain contextual information down the line. So what is bigger than apple, or what is bigger, apple or orange, let's say. And then the robot says maybe orange. And then you say, how about grapes? Then it won't, like most of the time it will fail it because it doesn't know what are you talking about. It lost the context that you are actually trying to compare the sizes of these fruits. So what we would try to have is like, okay, it should not, the answer to this question should be grapes are definitely the smallest, they're not bigger, rather than what about grapes, or it's a fruit. So this, we do not need to have these lame conversations.
Right. Yeah, right.
So according to you, like right now, how deployable are social robots? Like, I mean, we are in, like, especially in India, I would say, we're not yet habituated to, an environment where we are, seeing robots on our streets. For example, if I say in foreign countries, we have robotic mops going around in the houses, and there are robot delivery vehicles, and there are cabs coming up everywhere. But in a society like India, we're not yet adopted. Right. Even in the context of social robotics also, we're not yet habituated in the world. So how deployable are we looking at? Like, have we tested it with people? Have we taken some people come and like people who are doing research on it? That's fine. As you said, we might be a bit biased towards that. But
yeah.
How are we seeing the general perception of people? How are we measuring that factor?
So, I mean, you definitely have this. So human-robot interaction is an entire field that is dedicated to finding how and what shapes these interactions with humans and robots. So they conduct these experiments, they have these trials, they have these surveys and all this stuff. But talking from the perspective of India that you said, I think it's not entirely true that we are not exposed. I mean, you might have seen these news reports of robot waiters going around in some restaurants in Bangalore.
And yes. Right? So yes, even in South India, they are trying to bring it.
So, I mean, once you introduce it, it's, so when I say social robot, why do we always think of something that is already an all-capable machine? It could just be a waiter in a restaurant, but then you could slowly develop. Like right now, I'm pretty sure they do not have a behavior control architecture or anything. They just go, they have designated paths probably, and then just go and give the tray. I'm sure they are not even going and placing the tray on the table. It will just be stand like this, and then user takes it, right? But then it's already there. Also, I think I forgot to mention this. So you remember that robot Cosmo, which was just a small truck like this?
Yeah, that's also a social robot.
You can have pets as social robots, right? You can have a toy. Yeah, there is a lot of research.
Do we call Spot, Boston Dynamics Spot, do we call it a social robot? Is it
not sure if I know that name, like
the dog,
the dog one. It's a social, it can be a social robot, but the problem with Boston Dynamics is everything is intellectual property for them. All we have is access to videos, that's it. So we don't know what they are, right? No, but think of it, like you can have pet, like pet robots, like a dog robot, you can have a pet, and that's a social robot because at the end of the day, you are able to connect emotionally with the robot and it's able to invoke emotions in you. So in that respect, it's a social robot. Also, I mean, think of it. If you go and see the video of Cosmo, that Wall-E type small robot, so you would expect what can this do even? But it can do so many things. It can show expressions. It can talk. It can have these small gestures of like throwing a fit of anger and all this stuff. So a small toy is already sufficient to expose you and prepare you for a robot like maybe iRobot or something, the Sunny from iRobot. So exposure, we are eventually getting exposed, I think. Any kid who has played with a remote control car is already exposed to some sort of autonomous vehicle, right?
Yes, exactly. Right. So, one more thing that I had in mind I wanted to ask. With the growth of technology, I mean, not exactly robotics, let us put it this way, saying, you know, Instagram, Facebook, social media, let me put it in this way. Right. We kind of are, you know, engaged more in it, and that is how the platform's done. So don't you think increase in social robotics would also, you know, hamper human-to-human interaction? It is there to provide an emotional support. It is there to resemble a human, but this aspect of, you know, human to human interaction, would it in any way hamper that?
I mean, why would it hamper? I mean, of course, you could get addicted to it, theoretically speaking, like we are addicted to smartphones, but we are not, it depends too. I mean, I can make speculations, but this needs to be, if I talk from a point of view of a researcher, then we need to conduct studies and ascertain whether this is going to be a case or not. But it totally depends on what the application is. Like, if you have a robot that's a personal assistant, and then it is able to converse like any other human being would be with you, then probably a few people would just, like, those who do not have a lot of friends or those who are like, they like to keep to themselves, then I don't see any point for them to even go out anymore.
Okay.
We see these episodes from Black Mirror or all this stuff, and I think they have certain things like this. So yeah, it's likely possible. But then again, as is the case with any technology, there would be positive aspects and then there would be negative aspects, which might not even have thought about right now.
Right.
But then if we stop going ahead, then we are forever stranded. Like, we cannot proceed. We cannot progress.
True.
So that's also why I think it is very crucial for us to take this ethics side of this research very, very strongly. Because we are working in a domain like the AI in general, not only social robotics. The entire AI community needs to take ethics very seriously because, I mean, just think about it. You have deep learning models. What are you doing at the end of the day? You're feeding some data, learning some weights, and at the end of the day, you're just classifying something. Yeah. So if you misclassify it, or if there is a bias into it, and you deploy these models in commercial or maybe even crucial emergency situations, and God forbid, something bad might happen just because of the bias. Like you see, it's, we see these models that are unable to identify Black people in certain cases. And then we, let's say we deploy it in an emergency vehicle. We have this nice robot which is able to secure people from emergency areas because the firefighters cannot go there. The robot just collects all the white people or non-black people and then leaves because it could not even identify. Not the robot's fault, our fault, right? So
we need to be careful about that. More like how I look at it would be that when we are trying to imitate a neuron of human brain, mm-hmm. and slowly we are moving towards trying to like copy the structure of how humans behave, see object detection, everything is like human. So even mm-hmm. when you look at the history of human evolution, things such as not being racial bias were incorporated with time. We also had right. to teach ourselves to not differentiate between white and black. So it is just same mm-hmm. in the evolution of history of AI as well. Because we are trying to
imitate. I mean, I'm not sure about what you say is true or not, because I don't know, frankly. I do not know how we, I'm not sure how we came to even have this bias about difference between black and white. But anyways, what you said is true. So yeah, but the way how we have reached a point we are having to like, tackle these situations, or like we know that this is a bad thing to differentiate between these, is because we are talking about it and we have some things called morals and ethics. So we also need to have this similar to what you said. We also need to have it in AI community for sure.
Hi, Chinmay.
I'm not getting the audio.
Yeah, Nikhil, your voice is very low.
Hello, are you able to hear me?
Yeah. I'm able to hear.
Yeah.
So from an implementation view, so mm-hmm. how is it implemented? I mean, what packages are you using? So for example, you have a speech recognition system inside it.
Great.
And you have a, based on the application, you'll have object detection system.
Mm-hmm.
Or how will you invoke a particular system depending on what user is asking?
Depending on what user is asking. So, I mean, you could have all these systems run in parallel. Okay, let's take, for example, what I just showed you.
So now if I ask how many people are there in the room,
right?
So it needs to run the object detection system. It cannot run the,
right.
It should automatically take the speech and run the object detection system, right? And how it is happening, right. Like, it is parallelly running. Yeah,
you have a camera on the robot, right? Let's simplify things. So you have a camera. You are able to see everything in your surrounding via this camera. You have an object detection model that is able to detect the objects, and it is also able to identify persons. So you already have this data. You have these bounding boxes, you have the YOLO model or whatever you can. So you can always run these things in parallel. It keeps on running continuously. So yeah, now when you ask the robot that how many people are there in this room, now you are not invoking a model because it's already running. You already have this object. What it is doing in the backend is, okay, now it took, you did the ASR, it took it and understood that it is a question. From this question, it goes and then it sees, okay, do I have this data? Now, okay. Of course, your model is giving you the data, but unless you have a backend system that is already storing this data or giving access to this query system to access that data, you won't get the result. So what you need to focus on, how you manage these back channels or how you manage these querying and question answering these stuff. So
yeah.
Not necessarily that you need to run something every time something is asked, but it is run in parallel. So all these sensors are usually active. Also, what we do certain times is we have this hierarchical model. So let's say you came to a point and then we say, okay, how many people are there? And then the robot says, oh, it's not there. Then we could always have the system that says, okay, now from the input data, you extract this particular information and then you trigger this particular model of extracting the information. So maybe you are not always running the model and cluttering the data, but you are running it only when asked for to do that. And talking about
packages, interactive queries.
Yes, of course. Regarding the packages and stuff, so it depends on the robotic platform. So there is this operating system that are being developed for robots. There is a robotic operating system. In my past lab, they developed an entire operating system called FinRock. So many people have their own architectures, and in this architecture, then you have this specific proprietary thing, you know, how these things work or what is the interface, what are the models. So that's how it works. I mean, basically, Of course, you can use all the commercially available modalities. I mean, you can, for example, in this Farhat, you are using the commercially available Google Speech Recognizer or Amazon Polly or all this stuff. So you need not implement everything from scratch, but you could already use the commercially available or the freely available things. But if you need to have more access to it, then of course you need to implement certain things like the speech part. Let's say I need to vary the prosody and then how do I intonate certain things? Or maybe I want to have a conversation in Hindi. Maybe it's not available, so I need to implement it. So depending on the application areas, you need to select and do things on your own or use from what is available.
Okay. Then suppose we have a robot, like for example, in Japan airports, there is a robot which will take you to a particular location.
Mm-hmm.
So if they will have a dashboard and we'll select a location and it will take us to that particular location.
Right.
So can we call this as a social robot because it is not, but it is having only rules, right? It is following a rule.
Fine. I mean, we don't care about what is happening in the back end. We care about what is happening in front of you when you're communicating. So let's say you met somebody at the airport and then you asked, can you please show me the way to, let's say, XYZ terminal. The person takes you and leaves you there. Same with the robot. You went to the robot. Can you please show me the way? So how is it different? So it was a social interaction that you had with the person. Now it's also a social interaction with the robot as well.
Okay.
Right. Also, I think it's a good point to make. We should not always limit our thinking to something like, okay, rule-based systems are not AI. That's not the case. Anything that you are unable to do it, anything you are able to automate and it is something beyond the scope of a normal algorithm is probably AI. It need not be the case that only ML and DL models are AI. No.
Yeah, I was asking this question because there is no interaction happening, just only one interaction happening. No? There is not continual dialogue between both the robot and person.
Yeah, I mean, fair enough, right? You could just have like that specific instance of interaction in itself is already sufficient. Maybe you do not also talk to the person when you are going to, like when he's showing you the way, probably you don't even talk to that person as well, do you? In some cases, like let's take, for example, you go get into an Uber or maybe a taxi. In some instances, you talk a lot with the driver. In some instances, you don't even talk at all. It's just pure transactional and it seems robotic enough. Like you enter, you greet, and then when you go out, you just pay and buy. That's it. So even the definition of what we call a social interaction is also something we need to think about. So are we trying to expect something more out of a robot, which we probably wouldn't out of a human being?
Yeah, I got it.
I guess we are done with questions. Any more?
Anyone in the audience having any questions can...
I guess not. We can wind it up. It was great having you here, Chinmay. Like last few sessions, we have been so focused on the architectures that exploring a new domain in a holistic approach is a very refreshing thing and a very nice introduction to it. How everything integrates to social robotics,
right.
And it doesn't matter if you have been into NLP so far or computer vision or speech, you can jump into social robotics if you have the motivation to do so. Yes. And it was very, very nicely explained and we had a great discussion as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me as well.
Thank you, Chinmay. Thank you for taking time.
Thank you, Chinmay. Thank you.
Thank you so much.